just want to make a point though. We're taking agenda item 4 and 5 here together because I know there's some people looking to each other at the back and continue.
Yeah, sorry, I'm a little bit hoarse there, but I've got tonsillitis, so I do apologise. Can everyone hear me okay?
Yeah.
Okay. Basically, I've been working with Mark and Tracy to see what the fire rescue service have got to offer in terms of this hub. So what we're going to do, because we feel it's right and proper to do, is co-locate our hospital advocate as soon as the hub is up and running into the hub so that they can make the links between the council, the police and all the other agencies so that we have that interoperability to respond efficiently and effectively. So straight away we're going to do that as soon as possible. What else is important is we already have very sophisticated ways of engaging with the most vulnerable people in society from a fire perspective, but we also greatly affect the wider determinants of health as well. So from a prevention perspective, we're launching Safe and Well in April, which will affect bowel screening, cancer bowel screening, hypertension, falls, alcohol and tobacco, and we're also looking at smart home concepts and a number of other different ways of engaging from a prevention perspective. But from a community safety perspective, the hub's absolutely fantastic, but people don't live in hubs, people live in our communities. So what we do is, we do the data crunching, we do the qualitative bit, the quantitative bit in the hub, and then we go into the communities that really need us most, and we do it as one big asset. So the pool of resources maximises our efficiencies. So when you were talking about earlier, you don't see your PCSOs to the same extent, and they can't always feed back intelligence. It's not just the PCSO's job and the police's job to be able to do that. It's also partner agencies' jobs. For some people, it's a little bit of a step too far to report something to a police officer, but they might talk to someone from a housing association, they might talk to someone from the fire and rescue service, they might talk to somebody from the council. And then we can work with the police to inform our partners via our volunteer relationships or the care line, which I'm sure police colleagues can cover in more detail. Also, you've got the likes of Crime Stoppers, which we're trying to push so that the people in our community are less vulnerable to crime because they're more resilient, and the more they share with us, the more we're able to link in and affect better. And that's all different types of issues, from fly tip and secondary fires to arson attacks and serious and organised crime. And to give an example, was last week's campaign in the Edmont area, where we went in as multi-agencies, not just the Fire and Rescue Service, on this occasion because it was arson week, the Fire and Rescue Service led, but we didn't just have Wirral assets in Wirral, we have force assets in Wirral, so that it acts as a hybrid to be able to draw those resources in from the Fire and Rescue Service, from the police, to be able to put them in the areas that need them most. And that's not just for 1 week, that's going to be every month ongoing for the next 12 months, and we're committed to doing that over and above what will be your normal day-to-day activity, which is done fantastically well through the local policing teams, the local fire teams, the councils, etc. So there's a very much a hybrid approach there, where we're trying to be as agile as we can to get to the
some of those I picked up here, and I didn't want this to be statistic heavy, but I thought it was important to realise that even in just that short space of time where we've been doing this closer working and these new ways of working, the crime rate on Wirral is down 2%. It's 2%. It's the lowest in Merseyside and the third lowest in our metropolitan sector group. So there's some real success factors happening now. ASB is down 11% on last year. And again, I know when I said that before about this reduction, that's a continuing reduction, and people will say, well, people just don't report it anymore. Well, that's for you and us to make sure they do report it. So if it's not down because there's issues going on, we need the communities and those people to bring in and tell us about those. And then I just thought it was important to put down as well, even early days in our domestic abuse work, MARACS, the committee, the multi-agency group that looks at the high level, high risk cases and repeat victimisation below the national average. And we've got this project working. Tracy mentioned before, the Integrated Offender Management Unit is looking at this cohort of, you know, 15 or 16 of the most highest prolific domestic abuse risk perpetrators, if you like, that might be out on licence or out there in the communities, being intensively managed. We think that's had a direct result in that repeat cases are going down because we're managing those people. And it's interesting that if you'd asked me that 12 months ago, and I'm not criticising the probation service who lead on IOM or the police, yeah, but that domestic abuse cohort, it replaced an element of acquisitive crime, which was shoplifting. So in the world of priorities that we're dealing with, I'm not saying shoplifting should be ignored, I'm absolutely not, because it doesn't get ignored. The issue is that when you've got reducing resources, it can't make sense if we've got people, you know, undertaking serious crimes of harm and harmful practices against in relationships and people stealing things. So I think it's a real success factor. Last slide, Chair, before I ask questions. I just wanted to really pick up on what are the key bits. The CSF here talks about what are the critical success factors. So the critical success factors for me around this up are in this circular diagram. So reputation, we've all put our reputations, if you like, on the line here. When this up's co-located and formed, if it goes forward, then the reputation of all those agencies of this is the better way to work, working hand in hand with the local policing team, has got to be the right way forward. It meets our statutory requirements. But up in the right-hand corner and at the top, I wanted to just pick up two of those bits, really. There's been a massive reduction in funding that's available around community safety. Okay, those will remember the days when one of my erstwhile colleagues, Caroline Langwood, has stood up here and said, oh, I've got another X hundred thousand pounds from the government to do X, Y, and Z. Those days just aren't here anymore. Caroline often have a coffee in Starbucks in New Brighton, and I say, oh gosh, well, you know, to have some of that money. But we haven't. So we need to look at different ways that we, as the council side of this Safer Wirral Hall, can start to address this budget issue. And we're going to do that, we think, by looking at greater investment. So I took Tracy and Mark, we went up to Glasgow. So those who want to go online, look at the Safer Glasgow project. I know they did a lot of it on the back of the Commonwealth Games, but they've got an income stream there of a reputable private sector company, to be honest, whether it be for security services, whether it be for CCTV monitoring, whether it be for alarm monitoring in response. They're providing alarm monitoring for the southeast of England, in Glasgow. So these are in innovations that we're starting to look at. That hopefully, well, not hopefully, that will, with a proper business plan moving forward, allow us to start to look at selling those services that we think under the brand of a multi-agency or with the police, the fire, and ourselves there. Most people will say, actually, you know, if we're going to spend what little money we've got around security or around alarm monitoring, surely we can get a place with them rather than with somebody else. And that's really the tack we're starting to look on that. The budgets, the clarity to partners, So I put that there as critical success factors, because it would be wrong for us just to talk about the hub as a co-location and bringing resources. There are other elements to it that by the time we produce that final business case that needs to be signed off through the political process we move forward, we will have a number of work streams there and options that the politicians and yourselves as councillors can debate over actually and see the direction of going forward. The reality is, if we don't do that, you all sat there and listened to lots and lots of people talk about the amount of revenue that's going to be available as we move forward. And the reality of this is, we've got to get some income streams in to keep the partnership going the way it needs to go. Otherwise, it becomes statutory provision, and we'll be back to basic level, ripping up and starting again about what we do. So I'm going to stop there, Chair, if it's okay. I'm happy to take questions.
Okay, just before you do,
something that we very, very successful there. And I'm wondering whether that's something that, that should be looked at from the side of these players. Because going from the statement that somebody made about people will talk to the firemen and they won't talk to the police officers, maybe sometimes in certain areas. I know there's no-go areas for police, but firemen can go there and vice versa. They do it in North Yorkshire. That's been very, very successful there.
What we have got currently going on between Merseyside Police and Merseyside Fire and Rescue Service is a collaboration piece of work, which is predominantly being driven by government through the Crime and Policing Bill. So they've almost mandated us to collaborate. So that's a piece of work that the likes of myself, Tracy and other colleagues would feed in comments about observations on, but it's very much a bespoke piece of work that there's a specialist team working on. So that specialist team will report on ideas and frameworks through to a larger scale board right up to chief officer level. So there's a number of initiatives that are being explored. I think what we're doing at the moment though is integrating staff flexibly to respond to issues on the ground. What will work in one area might always cross-reference into another. And what we have seen from the Fire and Rescue Service perspective is dramatic cuts on Merseyside. So, you know, you heard police colleagues before about the numbers of cuts to police officers, but we've moved from 42 whole-time fire appliances down to 24. So that's a dramatic cut. So we do need to explore different ways of doing things, but what we can't immediately do is move firefighters off frontline fire appliances into certain areas, because our response standards, as you've seen at the major incident at the weekend, are very, very important. So it's about striking a balance between the two, and I think Merseyside Fire and Rescue Service are probably the best at doing that in the entire country.
Thank you, Chair, and thanks to everyone for the presentations. Really interesting stuff. I appreciate all the progress you've made so far. Just want to bring back to the report from page 33 to 35. I know you touched on this about data slipping. I'm just wondering, you probably don't have all the detail today, but which of these have you met so far? And would you send out something to members about which targets have been achieved and where you're to, you know, specifics? And as well as that, just on the actual reporting as well, how you know you'd achieve that. Obviously, one of the next items is the performance report. A lot of them don't actually have any data because I don't know how we're going to actually come on to that, I suppose, when we get there. But there's a couple that we haven't got, like public feeling safe and so on. I assume we've got to do another survey and so on. Just wondering when's all that going to come in? And there's a couple of them as well that don't seem to have any indicator at the moment. So the repeat incidents of hate crime and the repeat victims of antisocial behaviour. So they don't seem to have any sort of indicator at all. And finally, as again, this might come up later, the increase in fixed penalty notices and the litter, it still seems the wrong measure. That's the measure if you want to make money as a council. Reducing the number of people who are littering and dog fouling is the actual end goal of the thought, rather than having more fixed penalties.
Chair, I'll lay through you. Yeah, you're exactly right, Councillor. I did say there when we set off on this journey 12-18 for that first year, there was no doubt we were very ambitious, and it was a partnership approach to this, so we were certainly trying to accommodate the whole partnership's views on what they wanted as the outcomes. And if I'm being honest, I don't think we quite got smart about the actions as they were laid out in the pledge. Certainly for the next year going forward, the partnership should be going through a review of those, and there's a list of suggested outcomes that are just waiting for final sign-off, but we'll share them certainly with the committee. You'll hopefully see that they're far more smarter in terms of measurable actions, which you then as a committee will be able to say, where are we up to, what's this, and you'll see that movement. At the moment, I should have also said this piece of work, certainly the integration work, is one of the transformation projects that's ongoing at the moment. So it goes through a whole series of transformation reports and into a board, and there is quarterly reports of the pledges that are produced, which will demonstrate in a red and a green rating on where they are.
I accept again that in that process it might not have sufficient narrative and councillors might want to inquire more deeply on those, but I'll certainly share the last quarter of those to the committee so they can see that they haven't seen them before. We've got action plans behind all of these under the pledge of leads in terms of where we're up to. Some of those have had to be refreshed given that we didn't quite know the outcomes of some of the restructures that were going in partner agencies. We weren't too sure, including ourselves here, when I'm saying about some of those outcomes. So, yes, it needs smartening up. I certainly take those on board, but there is a performance measurement process through those pledges and that transformation project on the integration work as well.
I am aware, because it's the next item, that there are, what I think I'm putting for those is that they don't meet the narrative at the end of the report. I mean, I know we've discussed this before, but there's at least two that aren't reported on at all. The repeat offences, if you like, and then some of the others, I assume. It's when we do an ex-survey, which if we don't do one of them for 5 years, 10 years, or whenever we're going to do, so 18 months, so we'll know then. So I'm just wondering how you measure it as you go along, because obviously if you wait 18 months and there's no improvement, we need to be feeding this back in, don't we? So we need to do get some form of feedback on whether people are feeling safe as we're going along to make sure we're on the right track, rather than wait until 18 months ago or something having any impact.
Yeah, you're right. The project is, again, some of this project work has been quite challenging on how we measure the success. Because if you talk about an integration project, how do you measure the success of putting a PCO in the community control officer? I can come back and say to you, it saves 23 million pence on each renewal because we're sharing a vehicle. But actually, what does that mean to us? Not a lot. So it's very much we're capturing through diaries and through regular meetings with those, the qualitative data from the officers and the public they interface with about how we found that, how it worked, and that will be captured in that final business case we go forward. The survey has been answered by Councillor Davis, that's going to be in 18 months' time. We're doing, and we're looking to do through the anti-social behaviour teams and the local policing teams, communications within those communities that were the areas that gave us the high rating, if you like, because there were some bespoke areas across the Wirral that made that 60%, because it was almost 100% in that area that they felt unsafe, whereas in others it wasn't. So the community outcome of the survey was that. So we're doing drill down work in those. It wouldn't surprise members to understand that those same communities are the ones that are probably receiving the majority of the target action that's going on anyway, because they'll be the areas where they either suffer more antisocial behaviour or more crime. So we are capturing those, and specifically things like hate crime. The police, and again, Tracy, if might be able to add more, but we're trying to, they as a force are trying to move away from numerical data as something to present out there, because it only takes one incident, such as the Noctorum example that was used, where suddenly